We move now from the UN to the periphery in the sense of now we'll talk about Taiwan. Right after lunch, we'll talk about Hong Kong. We don't have time to cover Tibet or Xinjiang, but these are two crucial areas. I worry a lot about the Taiwan situation. It seems to be deteriorating. We had the 8 years under Ma Ying-jeou. Remember, he was here last spring, I guess it was. And the election of Madam Tsai, who really is one of us in the sense of she too has a LLM in law from Cornell and a doctorate from LSE and is trying to steer, you might say, between Scylla and Charybdis, trying to maintain relations with the mainland without sacrificing Taiwan's future. So I think some people think China will take advantage of our distraction over North Korea, not only to keep moving in the South China Sea, but also to press Taiwan in ways that we should be paying more attention to. I don't know if you saw in yesterday's, I think, New York Times, a very depressing report about Taiwan's military, contrasting China's new submarines with Taiwan trotting out a 1945 submarine that barely could move. The whole thing, I think, bears much more watching than we have been able to give it. We're lucky to have Yu-Jie Chun, a recent doctorate graduate of this school who spent many years working on human rights matters relating to Taiwan, now is at Taiwan's leading academic legal institution at Academia Sinica. And she's going to talk for a while about a major case that is a matter of considerable concern. I looked this morning to see whether the decision had come down for the sentencing, but as far as I know, it hasn't. But she'll talk. I may make a few comments, and then we can have a discussion. Yu-Jie, glad to see you.
Thank you, Jerry. Thank you. It's an honor to be back to the law school. My task today is to discuss a very important subject that often gets sidelined in cross-strait relations. Can you all hear me in the back? Good. Okay. And this subject is human rights in China-Taiwan relations. First of all, why should we talk about human rights in cross-strait relations? Of course, this topic matters to the human rights practice of both China and Taiwan, but it also matters to the stability of cross-strait relations, which has implications for the stability of the region. More broadly, I think it really begs the question of what kind of principles based on which the outside world should engage with China. Especially for liberal democracies, it's very important to integrate human rights in its bilateral relations with China, and it's urgently so for Taiwan, and I'll talk about why. So for our discussion today, I'll focus on the highly publicized case of Mr. Li Mingzhe, the Taiwanese rights activist who has been detained in China for his rights activism, mainly on Chinese social media, for more than 7 months now. And this case has caused great tension across the Taiwan Strait. And it's also an example of how China's human rights practice has an impact beyond its border. But before going into this topic, I would like to give you a bit about the context of the general cross-strait cooperation and cross-strait agreements. As many of you know, Beijing has now suspended much cooperation with Taiwan since President Tsai Ing-wen took office in May 2016. Xi Jinping's plan is apparently to use this passive-aggressive tactic of non-cooperation to pressure Tsai Ing-wen to accept Beijing's position that Taiwan is part of China. But if we go back in time a little bit to look at the Ma Ying-jeou era, when President Ma Ying-jeou was in office from 2008 to 2016, his KMT government adopted a reconciliation policy with China. And at the time, cross-strait cooperation was on the rise, and Taipei and Beijing, through their semi-official organizations, signed 23 bilateral agreements. These agreements mainly focus on economic matters and technical matters, except for the important exception of the judicial assistance agreement, which I'll discuss later. The cross-strait agreements were very useful in enhancing cross-strait cooperation, but they have also been criticized in Taiwan for lacking democratic supervision. Ma's executive branch really did not give Taiwan's legislature a chance to review and approve most of these agreements. And this problem of marginalizing democratic supervision was one of the foremost reasons that triggered the Sunflower Movement, the very popular Taiwan movement, in 2014. And during that movement, students stormed in the legislative chamber and camped out there for 24 days, paralyzing the operation of the legislative yuan, and hundreds of thousands of people took it to the streets to protest against Ma's dealings with China. So let me go back to our focus today, which is Li Mingzhe's case and the relevance of the judicial assistance agreement to this case. So the judicial assistance agreement, it has a jawbreaker name. Its full name is Cross-Strait Agreement on Joint Crime Fighting and Mutual Judicial Assistance. But for short, I'll just call it Judicial Assistance Agreement, or the JAA. It's really an exceptional agreement. It was signed in 2009, early into Ma Ying-jeou's first term. It's exceptional because, unlike all the other agreements, it touches upon very sensitive political matters, including jurisdiction, crime investigation, repatriation of criminals. The agreement is also significant because it involves so many issues at the intersection of criminal justice and human rights. And there's one important requirement in this agreement, Article 12. It is the agreement for one government, for each government, to give prompt notification upon detaining persons from the other side and to facilitate family visits to the detained person. And Beijing simply ignores these requirements in handling the case of Mr. Li Mingzhe. So now we come to this case. Why is Li Mingzhe's case important? This case, needless to say, has been in the headlines in Taiwan and beyond. It's a major case worth of our attention because China's blatant violations of not only Li Mingzhe's human rights, but also the JAA that it agrees to with Taipei. Moreover, this case is meant to send a warning to overseas NGO activists who try to promote democracy and human rights in China. So I'll give you a little bit case specifics. What really happened? So Mr. Li has been a long-term volunteer for Taiwanese human rights NGOs. He often discussed on Chinese social media human rights issues and Taiwan's experience of transitioning from an authoritarian regime to a vibrant democracy. he called for support for the families of the detained Chinese rights activists and lawyers. He sometimes sent Taiwanese books on history and literature to his friends in China, and he traveled to the mainland every year to see them. And this year, 2017, Mr. Li went into China through Macau on March 19, and then disappeared. At the time, no one knew his whereabouts, but people suspected that his disappearance was connected to his rights activism on Chinese social media, as well as in China. Months later, we learned what happened at the time. When he entered China, he was immediately put under residential surveillance by the state security authorities in Guangdong. Residential surveillance, for those of you who are not familiar with the Chinese criminal justice system, residential surveillance sounds very innocuous, but it's actually one of the most abusive techniques used by the Chinese police to detain the person incommunicado for as long as 6 months. Residential surveillance really gives Chinese police a completely isolated environment where there's no check on nonstop interrogation and torture. So since Mr. Li's disappearance, what has Taipei done? The Taiwan government has consistently requested Beijing to provide information about Mr. Li's detention in accordance with the judicial assistance agreement. But Beijing has failed to give any notification required by the agreement. In fact, Beijing went to great lengths to avoid any prescribed channels to communicate with Taipei required by the agreement. 10 days into Mr. Li Mingzhe's disappearance, Beijing finally admitted in a regular press conference that Mr. Li has been placed in official custody on suspicion of endangering state security. But at this point, it's so bizarre that Beijing would still not go through the official or semi-official channels that are required in the judicial agreement to give notification of where Mr. Li was detained, and also the specifics of the case, nor did they let Li Mingzhe's family to visit him. In fact, Li Mingzhe's wife, Ms. Li Jingyu, did try to go to China in April to protest and find her husband, but she was told at the Taiwan airport that her China entry permit was revoked, and therefore she could not board the plane to China. Mr. Li was unfortunately formally arrested on May 11 this year on the charge of subverting state power. The trial occurred on September 11th. It only lasted for 4 hours. Basically, it was a formality. Everything was carefully rehearsed. The trial was webcast to the public and was meant to be a public display of Mr. Li's confession. Mr. Li's confession was not at all surprising, given that Chinese rights activists and lawyers have been made to confess in trials, and even on TV before there's even a prosecution. So what did Mr. Li confess? He confessed to spreading articles online that criticized the Chinese government and to participating in an organization to promote Western-style democracy. Li then expressed remorse over his actions, and he expressed gratitude to what he said was the civilized manner of the Chinese law enforcement. As I said, the trial was carefully rehearsed, and his remarks were apparently approved by the Chinese authorities. We don't have the verdict yet. It's already 2 months since September. And according to Chinese criminal procedure law, the verdict could come any time between now and November 11th, unless the court asks for an extension. Now, I think it's worth noting about the timing of the trial, because it was carefully arranged. Ms. Li had already planned to go to Geneva on September 10 to raise her husband's case with the United Nations Working Group on Enforced and Involuntary Disappearances. But just a few days before the trial and her planned trip to Geneva, a court-appointed lawyer contacted Ms. Li and then told her that she can finally attend the court proceedings. So Ms. Li went to China to finally see her husband for the first time after his disappearance. It's no coincidence that the trial was scheduled to overlap with Ms. Li's Geneva trip. The timing of the trial was obviously intended to prevent Ms. Li from speaking to United Nations human rights experts, and it's an attempt to minimize Taiwan's protests on the international stage. So, what does Mr. Li's case can tell us? First of all, I think Beijing is really doing a disservice to its professed policy to win the hearts and minds of Taiwanese people. And when Taipei Mayor Guo Wenzhe, who is known for being very candid, when he was asked to comment on the case, he said very bluntly and rightly that China, despite being a superpower, seemed to be out of step with the civilized world. And this is representative of the perception of many Taiwanese people of China nowadays. More broadly, I think the way Beijing handles Li's case has done a lot of damage to the credibility and legitimacy of cross-strait agreements. Beijing would not respect the agreements it signs with Taiwan when they prove to be politically inconvenient to Beijing. It suggests that we Taiwanese can hardly rely on these agreements to be treated seriously. These agreements are supposed to be providing the kind of institutional environment where both parties can respect their obligations under the arrangement that they both agree to in order to sustain long-term cooperation, rather than letting cooperation subject to political winds. And finally, we need to ask, is there any room for human rights in cross-strait relations? Is there anything that Taiwan can do to engage China in human rights? So I'll conclude with these remarks. I think the prospect for Taiwan to engage China in human rights issues seems very grim now, especially given that the cross-strait relations are at a low point. I wrote an article in 2015 when the both sides were still having sort of close ties. And come to think about it, some of the suggestions in that piece seem quite optimistic, too optimistic. But I hope that Professor Alstom's final remark during the previous panel would be vindicated, that these optimistic remarks may be useful. But I think, you know, even at this time of what many people called cold peace, 冷和平, in cross-strait relations, it's a good time for Taiwan to reflect on its policies in terms of how to protect its core values of democracy, human rights, and the rule of law in its relationship with this powerful neighbor that has an aggressive agenda to absorb Taiwan. And I think one pillar of this policy would be for Taiwan to integrate human rights in cross-strait cooperation seriously and emphasize that human rights issues would not be compromised to make way for economic and political cooperation. I think Taiwan should also do, you know, taking advantage of this time of a cool-off period with China to do more self-strengthening, meaning that Taiwan should enhance its own institutions for the purpose of protecting rights in its relationship with China. Taiwan needs institutions that can monitor the implementation of human rights laws, regulations, and practice in the cross-strait context, including previewing and reviewing its China policies and cross-strait agreements to make sure that human rights questions are properly taken into account. Right now, there's no such adequate mechanism in Taiwan. So to come back to Lee's case as my concluding remark, I think Taiwan should definitely publicize China's rights violations in this case and try to muster more international support for his release. And the international society should care because this case is intended by Beijing to send a loud and clear warning that not only Taiwanese NGO activists, but also foreign NGO workers, that they will all be in danger if they promote freedom and human rights in China at the current time. Thank you.
Well, that terrific talk raises so many issues. Let me just tick off a few and then I welcome. We've got lots of time for discussion relating to this and subsequent sessions. And by the way, this is personal. Are those of us who engage in supporting people in China in their efforts for a more democratic or a more human rights-oriented system or a genuine rule of law, are we now under potential threat? This was somebody working with people in China on human rights matters, somebody who lived in Taiwan. He went to China occasionally. And he has been now tried for subverting state power. According to the current regime of Xi Jinping, any of us who challenge the government, we are endangering state security. We're subverting state power as they conceive of state power. So for all human rights activists in Taiwan, Europe, America, whatever, this case raises a new threat of really prosecuting somebody whose essential activities are abroad, but who occasionally goes to China to support what we would call human rights. So that's it's a question for foreign NGOs, but it's also a question for universities and others, lawyers groups, individual lawyers who go and do the kinds of things we started doing in 1979 in China. And it is possible under an increasingly extreme interpretation to say that these are criminal violations. So we don't know how far this will go. It's interesting they've taken so long to decide on how to sentence this fellow. Should they give him a mild sentence or a very heavy sentence? What would be the implications? As Yu-Jie said, China wants not only to be recognized for its military and economic and political power, but for its really soft power reputation, for having a more civilized regime that's deserving of admiration by people all over the world. Another question, of course, is what is an agreement with China worth? We'll have that again when we talk about the joint declaration between the UK and China over Hong Kong after lunch. This comes up all the time now, and it comes up often in the context of sovereignty. When Australia had a dispute with China a few years ago over the interpretation of the consular agreement between Australia and China, China could have argued in terms of which side had the better interpretation of the treaty, but they didn't bother. Their spokesman for the foreign ministry simply said, nothing can interfere with China's judicial sovereignty, meaning even commitments China has made in the exercise of sovereignty can be ignored because China chooses to invoke sovereignty. It makes agreements a little perilous with China. The human rights questions, you know, you have almost 2 million Taiwanese living in China. Their rights are insecure, and you have many more people going between China and Taiwan, people from Taiwan. And they have to worry about disappearances and residential surveillance. I first got familiar with residential surveillance when Ai Weiwei disappeared. I'm a good friend of Ai Weiwei's. I'm gonna ask him to come and speak here sometime this year. And in April 2011, he just disappeared. But I confidently waited because I knew the police would give themselves 30 days if they treated this as a criminal case. And then they'd have to get the approval of the prosecutor, and that would take another 7 days. So I thought, on the 38th day, we'll discover where Ai Weiwei is and what his offense is alleged to be. But the 38th day came and went, no word. Then it dawned on me, they were giving him residential surveillance, which means the police give themselves 6 months to make up their minds what to do about somebody they take in who's in the meantime held incommunicado, no access to a lawyer, family, friends, just disappeared. And in some cases, it looks like they can renew the period. So it could be longer. And these events have happened to lawyers as well as their clients. So residential surveillance, there used to be before 2012 a rule under the Ministry of Public Security telling its police, you may not use residential surveillance to lock up people who have a residence in your city. So if somebody's got a house in Beijing like Ai Weiwei, he should not have been given residential surveillance. But after the 2012 revision of the criminal procedure law, China provided in that law three circumstances, supposedly narrowly drawn, and only in those three circumstances could the police lock up somebody under residential surveillance when the person has a residence in that place. But one of these exceptions is national security. And all the police have to do is say, we might suspect this person of really endangering national security, therefore we can lock them up, and we'll find out over the next 6 months or longer whether they really have engaged in this or not. And then we'll put them into the formal criminal process. In the meantime, they've avoided all the time limits and other procedural requirements that China's criminal justice system provides. Well, there are so many other questions. This whole business about the treatment of people with putting them on TV before they're even charged and then having their trial broadcast. Now in China, it's remarkable. Millions of cases are being made available to the public. And generally, that's a good thing. But of course, what's the selection process? And how is this new technique of openness? Supposedly, it's a demonstration of trial-centered justice. That's the new theme. But of course, if the case is decided before the trial, as it used to be, once again, that isn't much in the way of justice. The UN role here is an interesting one. We just heard about the UN and possibilities for getting human rights relief. Li Mingzhe's wife is a very commendable character. She's very much like some of the wives of the mainland lawyers who've also gone to bat for their detained husbands, or a few cases, husbands who've gone to bat for their detained wives. So this attempt to get the Working Group on Arbitrary Detention of the UN to help. They have many, many times condemned Chinese detentions as arbitrary. The problem is it doesn't make much of a dent in public opinion in the world. And the Working Group really should do more to publicize its output, and the US and other countries should do much more to participate in that publication process. Finally, you just mentioned the question of international law and Taiwan's status lurks behind a lot of these problems. In 1950, we had to make a decision. Were we going to put the US fleet in the Taiwan Strait and stop Chairman Mao from taking Taiwan? In January, we decided we would not interfere because Taiwan was part of China, even though that status had not yet been formalized by the post-war peace treaties. But June 27th came along, North Korea invaded South Korea. We could have interpreted that as a domestic civil war, a communist threat in Korea only. But instead, the US interpreted it as an attack by international communism, not only in Korea, but also in Taiwan and also in Indochina. And without any public debate, we simply reversed our position and announced that Taiwan really wasn't yet part of China, but its status was undetermined and would have to await a peace treaty that would conclude it, or UN trusteeship or other action by the UN, or the restoration of security in the Pacific. President Truman did a 180-degree flip, and Dean Acheson, for whom I later worked in the law firm in Washington and was a great lawyer, they all flipped. But China remembers all this. They remember that in January we said Taiwan is really part of China. Mr. Acheson then said, January 12, 1950, if we went to the defense of Taiwan, no country in Asia would be happy because they would see us as interfering with the territorial integrity of an Asian country. But by June 27th, everything had changed in our view. And after that, John Foster Dulles, who was successor to Acheson when the Republicans took over in 53, crafted the peace treaty arrangements to make sure that the legal status of Taiwan was never formally clarified. So we have a fascinating technical question of international law. When Chiang Kai-shek's forces were placed in control of Taiwan October 25, 1945, and he reincorporated Taiwan into China, should that be recognized as de facto restoration of Taiwan to China? Or because no peace treaty ever confirmed that, in the peace treaty, Japan renounced all claim to Taiwan, but the treaty never said to whom did they renounce the claim. So you have a very interesting question. Now, I didn't care too much about this question from the Taiwan point of view as long as Chiang Kai-shek ran a very tough military dictatorship that was just as vicious as generally what took place on the mainland. But now here we are 67 years later. Taiwan is not under Chiang Kai-shek. Chiang Kai-shek used to say, Taiwan is free China. And many people would say, nonsense, it's neither free nor China. And yet he was a master propagandist in the American public eyes, and his wife was even better. But now we have a different situation. Taiwan is genuinely free. It is an impressive democratic state. Are we going to take the same position? Does international law remain the same regardless of political change in a country? This is a terrific problem, and it's not just an interesting theoretical legal problem. This is going to be a very tough problem with respect to, are the American people, if necessary, going to go to the defense of Taiwan? Given all our other liabilities and difficulties and responsibilities, and should we? That's really the background for a lot of these things. Well, we've got 23 minutes. Do you want to comment?
Yes, I do. I have some comments in response to Jerry's, your excellent remarks. So you mentioned that this is a new threat. And yes, it is a new threat to Taiwanese NGOs, very alarming. And there was an article on NewsLens newspaper some time ago interviewing Taiwanese civil society activists very extensively. And they were all saying this case has produced chilling effects among Taiwanese NGOs. And you know, before this case, they had never thought of that their speech on social media, including Chinese social media, could be used to convict them and charge them and convict them in China. And so now they also are very aware of this danger, and including their remarks on Facebook and Twitter. WeChat and QQ, those Chinese media. Taiwanese NGOs have become a more prominent place in terms of having exchanges with Chinese rights lawyers and activists. As many of you know, Hong Kong used to be a safe place to conduct such exchanges, and there was cooperation between Chinese civil society groups and Hong Kong groups. But now Hong Kong is thought to be, some would say, thought to be less safer than Taiwan. And Taiwan has been having exchanges with Chinese rights activists for many, many years, and it's continuing and it's expanding. So I commend Taiwanese NGOs for giving more attention to this issue. I think during the Chen Shui-bian era, Taiwanese civil society's attitude was more or less that this is none of our business. Chinese human rights situation was sort of considered remote, and because of the cross-strait relations at the time was not so close, and many people, including Taiwanese civil activists, did not know much. But they gradually learned the serious situation in China, especially given the recent deteriorating repression in China. So they're extending their hands and trying to offer more support to Chinese civil society. The UN role is an interesting question, because Taiwan has been excluded from the United Nations since 1971, and Taiwanese civil society groups have attempted to submit its complaints to UN human rights mechanisms and have never been successful until more recently. And the case of Li Mingzhe is the second successful complaint that Taiwanese groups were able to send in the UN-related human rights mechanism. And in this case, it's the Working Group on Enforced Disappearance. So it's unprecedented that the Working Group on Enforced Disappearance was willing to take on this case and was willing to arrange a meeting to meet with Ms. Li. And because Ms. Li could not go, so Taiwanese NGOs went in her stead and were able to after many difficulties, were able to enter the UN building in Geneva to speak with the experts. But it wasn't easy to just to try to, you know, get entry into the UN building. Taiwan's international isolation has practical implications for its human rights practice on the ground. Taiwan, despite its isolation from the UN human rights system, has ratified many human rights treaties, including the ICCPR, the ICSER, the treaties on women's rights, children's rights, and the rights of the persons with disabilities. But all this has been done without any UN support whatsoever. And therefore, Taiwan cannot, like other states, go to Geneva to accept the monitoring of the treaty bodies. But Taiwan very creatively self-established human rights treaty review mechanisms in Taipei to review Taiwan government's implementation of these treaties. So independent experts have been invited to Taiwan to conduct sort of a Geneva-like treaty review. And Professor Cohen and Professor Philip Austin of this law school have both been invited to serve in this capacity. So I think Taiwan is doing more, but it also needs more international support in its human rights, international human rights protection.
I must say the experience of sitting on a treaty body-like committee in Taiwan is very different from that in Geneva. You have much more time. We had three solid days of meetings. The NGOs don't have to travel to Geneva. Most can't afford to go anyhow. But they're right there at home in Taiwan, and they're all over you like a tent. I've done this twice, 2013, 2017. I've never seen such a comprehensive NGO effort. And the first time, they would follow me to the bathroom. They were really something. And it was a very impressive show also by the government. This was an imaginative effort on the part of Taiwan. It's going to continue. And it raises the question I've often thought of, what can we do with respect to other questions of international law, including the legal status of Taiwan? If the parties will never go to International Court of Justice or to an arbitration tribunal or some other third party, even for mediation, should NYU Law School have some kind of a forum where we thoroughly vet all these issues, recognizing we can't have any legal effect, but we might have an important public educational impact? What are the limits of imagination in international law? We are going to get to the questions now, but I just have one more point. When the Li Mingjia case came out, for a few days at least, I was very cautious, because we've had cases like this involving people from Taiwan that turn out to be spy cases. I was involved in one of these about 15 years ago, a case of a woman named Gao Zhang. We mobilized huge scholarly protests here because she had been detained and arrested in China, and she appeared to be a scholar from Taiwan who'd got her PhD from the Maxwell School at Syracuse. And we were really outraged interfering with her research on the mainland, but it later turned out she was a spy. And in this case, I wondered, it worried me. But after a while, we saw it wasn't. And of course, he's never been charged with any spying activity. He hasn't been a sense of that at all. But I was cautious. But now, of course, I've become quite concerned. And we have to be concerned with these problems in this country also. And question will now arise, does Taiwan have to worry about kidnappings? We have seen that China has been kidnapping people in Thailand, in Vietnam, and in other places. They had secret agents here trying to sweet talk Guo Mingwei, who's such a troublesome character, into going back to China. We don't know the extent to which China is going to try to use its increasingly aggressive secret police to spirit people away, starting with Taiwan. They've already done it in Hong Kong, of course, but Hong Kong is formally part of the PRC. It doesn't justify kidnapping from Hong Kong. So this case has all kinds of implications, but I'm hoping we have at least stimulated you to ask questions or make some comments. Ken? Use the mic, please, Ken. Ken Wasserman is the leading lawyer student of China who comes to all our events, even though he's a busy lawyer.
Some of them, anyway. To what extent are there specific, reliable reports of the methods used by the Chinese to encourage confessions by those suspected of human rights criminal charges, and how did those reports be obtained?
I'm sorry, I didn't understand, so.
How are the reports obtained?
The methods that the Chinese use to coerce or encourage suspects in human rights cases to confess to certain crimes.
It's not easy. The information, of course, is not very transparent in China, but because of the release of some of the lawyers after a long time detention, we now know some details, and one of the lawyers published a very comprehensive account of torture during the prolonged detention. I think the torture techniques is sleep deprivation, and they are tied to chairs during interrogation. They're forced to stand in a very uncomfortable position. Most worrisome is that there's this new technique of forcing them to take medication, and we don't know what that medication is. Many lawyers have reported that they were asked to take medication every day, and we really don't know because there was no information of what that was, but it was very worrisome because those lawyers, you know, they are very fearless, but the most worrying thing for them would be to lose their sanity during interrogation and after release.
Some of them have been reduced to vegetable status, at least for a while. Li Chunfu, the younger brother of Li Heping, it's the saddest thing to see some of these people with their brains really affected. Many times on detention, they're told that they have high blood pressure, and they don't have high blood pressure, but they're given medicine for high blood pressure, which has some impact. There are a lot of these cases around. I think Yu-Jie is being rather conservative, and you have lots of people around who've been tortured, and we got some in this room who have some experience. Steve Orleans, president of the National Committee on U.S.-China Relations.
I notice you left out the role of the U.S. government. In both the Taiwan case and in human rights generally, in the context of President Trump being there in 48 hours, and in the context, let me read General Kelly's statement made to Fox News, because I think it's interesting and informative about the Trump administration's view of the U.S. government's role in this. They have a system of government that has apparently worked for the Chinese people.
I quoted that this morning in my opening remarks.
Which suggests that the administration is taking a view that, you know, this 1%, this 1/10 of 1%, or this 1/100 of 1% of Chinese society that is NGOs, civil activists, human rights lawyers, dissidents, is, you know, not that important. that what counts is the overwhelming majority. And I'd be surprised if President Trump is going to raise human rights as an issue, though I am told that the release of Liu Xia will be raised in the discussion. So there will be at least that one issue, looking for kind of very specific results from the discussions. In other words, it won't be kind of general discussions of rule of law, but discussions of a particular dissident being released. It won't be discussions about the economic structure of Chinese society. It'll be discussions of these 15 deals we want to be signed and announce that we've created, 17,321 jobs in the United States. I'd like your comments on what the U.S. government should be doing.
Well, that's a good question. I refer to it, as those of you who heard me at 9:15 can recall. It's upsetting to have the president not only saying much about human rights anywhere in the world, or even in this country, and then to have Mr. Kelly, who seems to be declining in his public recognition, talk about what the feelings of the Chinese people are. But I suppose the short answer is, why aren't the Chinese people allowed to say what their views are? Why are they being increasingly repressed so that we only can take the Communist Party view of what the people of China say, when the Communist Party, as I said earlier, is sort of the equivalent of our 1% in this country? So we have these problems. It's undoubted, you and I both know, we worked together for 2.5 years in China, 1979 to 81. There's been enormous progress, as Professor Alston noted earlier, in social economic terms in China. But the question is the cost. And does the cost have to be this high? That's what the world will have to look at. And Xi Jinping is going to be increasingly a challenge on that point. Yu-Jie, do you want to say anything?
No, but not on this point, but follow up on your remarks that I was very conservative in answering Ken's question. And yes, I did ignore some of the things because I did want to make a point about the new technique of using medication. But of course, there were beatings. We all know that there were beatings during interrogation, and they were brutal and horrendous. There were accounts available online, not only of that lawyer during this wave of crackdown since 2015, but even before that, Teng Biao's treatment under the Chinese police was definitely would constitute the torture, cruel, and degrading treatment and punishment under international law. And also the threats to family cannot be ignored. They were often, the Chinese activists, when they are in detention, they're often threatened that the security, the safety of their family would really be in danger. And that's a useful weapon against those Chinese lawyers. There are scholars and civil society groups that are trying to document all this despite the very difficult situation. But even that has become increasingly difficult.
The use of torture is a problem that we've been struggling with in the United States, of course. In fact, in some of our cooperative programs in China, we have shown the Chinese a film about the Central Park Five, the notorious case where torture in this city in New York caused five people to confess falsely. We have a project that Ira Belkin has been organizing and running about wrongful convictions, where we enable people from China and the United States and other countries in Asia to talk about why do wrongful convictions occur and what's the role of torture, incommunicado detention, etc. So these are problems that unfortunately will continue to plague us. But we should, I think, getting back to Steve's question, we should hope that the United States will play a more vigorous role. But whenever we do, of course, we have to worry that we don't look so good in some respects also, but at least we can read about it every day in our newspapers, and it starts a political process that often, not always, results in eventual just results. Alvin Chung will be our speaker after lunch.
Thank you. I wanted to come back to the issue that come back to the point that Mr. Li entered from Macau, which was something I'd not previously been aware of.
What about Macau?
Mr. Li entered the mainland from Macau.
Oh, yes.
And so I guess that raises the issue of what role the Macanese authorities may or may not have played, because we know from the Macanese Court of Final Appeal that the law enforcement authorities there have engaged in illegal renditions of individuals from Macau to the mainland. So do we know anything more about what happened with Mr.
Yes.
Lee?
Do you want to say?
Yeah, but
Don
also has a question. Do you want to collect?
I want to answer this very quickly. We can.
Yeah. So originally there was misinformation about Lee's disappearance in Macau, but later we learned that he entered Guangdong through Macau and was disappeared in Guangdong. So we don't know what kind of role, if any, Macau was playing in the detention of Mr.
There's no indication that I've seen that Macau played any role, except he landed in the airport, he crossed into Guangdong, and then they got him. So I don't think it's a Macau question here, although Macau has been involved in lots of questionable activities in the past. I want to move here. Don, and then Tony, and then was her hand in the back? Yes, Yinchur.
Hi, just a very brief comment and then a question for Yu-Jie. The comment is that just as a discursive matter, I hope that we could all stop saying medication and just say drugs.
Yes.
Medication sounds too benevolent.
Yes.
And my question for Yu-Jie is that when you talked about the measures that the Taiwanese government, for example, and others should take in response to China's violation of the Judicial Assistance Agreement, you talked about publicizing the violations and things like that. One thing you didn't mention was suspending cooperation under the Judicial Assistance Agreement or indeed under other agreements. And, you know, we've discussed this before, and I just wonder, what do you think? Is that a viable thing to do? And not even just limiting it to the JAA, but maybe going towards other agreements as well.
Do you want to collect those questions before?
Why don't you answer this one?
Oh, I only have, so we did have that discussion, and I would only quote Michelle Obama, when they go low, we go high. So I would urge Taiwan to follow these agreements, and it's a matter of principle, and I think it's the right policy for Tsai Ing-wen to remain really calm instead of provocative. Considering the really imbalance of power between Taiwan and China.
And they've got
and
to persuade.
I always think that international law is the weapon of weaker states, and we should stick to that route.
Trying to use it, but you have to have a forum, and who's going to observe this? I think Taiwan has to do much more to publicize its views, even while sticking to the agreements. Tony?
As to the residential surveillance, in 2011, many lawyers, activists, including me, Ai Weiwei, were kidnapped and disappeared, but the government told us it's resident surveillance in the designated place. And several months after that, China modified the civil criminal procedure law, and Article 73 and Article 84 actually legalized the enforced disappearance, also like solitary confinement, but they use the term resident surveillance in a designated place. So I think Li Mingzhe maybe faced the same thing that the Chinese government legalize some violation of human rights, maybe in the future, that kind of torture and abduction are legalized.
The Ai Weiwei case is interesting because using his artistic talents, he has exhibited to the world what residential surveillance was in his case. You could see it in the theater in London. You could see it in the biennial exposition in Venice. He's done a lot to show people just what kind of treatment he got, and he got very polite treatment because he was Ai Weiwei, of course. Yinchur.
Thank you, Yu-Jie, for this great talk. My question is related to Li Mingjie case per se. I read from media report, actually during the case developing, Li Mingjie's wife has received a phone call from a Chinese authority saying that if she's quiet, actually it's good for her husband's case. But if she wants to raise international influence, actually it's bad for his case. And given Mrs. Li's character personality, she chose the hard one. So I was wondering, what's your comment on this? And also, does international influence work as effective as it used to be? Or what's the alternative for this method, including give Chinese government pressure to do the right thing?
That's a great point from former Chinese judge Yinchur, who spent 6 years in the Chengdu High Court, or Intermediate Court.
Yeah, so Yinchur, you are referring to this middleman who contacted Ms. Li weeks into her husband's disappearance, and this middleman used to be a special assistant to a KMT politician. And he said, he didn't claim to represent Beijing, but he said he has contacted Beijing, and he was telling Ms. Li that it's the right thing to do to sort of keep silent and, you know, try to cooperate with Beijing to secure her husband's release. And Ms. Li is an unusual character. Usually spouses caught in this situation would choose to cooperate, but she's fearless. She decides to go public and refuse to cooperate or do any under table negotiations with Beijing or this middleman. And I think she was caught in a hard place, you know, between a hard place and the rock. And you know, because of herself was also doing work on Taiwan's White Terror period, and she perfectly is aware of the dangers involved, but she decides to fight back, and this is the way she fights back. We cannot comment whether this is right or wrong, whether if she had done things differently, whether that would have secured Li's release earlier, but I really admire her courage.
You know, this is a great reminder. Sometimes in these cases, officious, unauthorized intermeddlers appear, but this guy wasn't. Beijing, I think, recognized that they were in touch with him.
Yeah.
I mean, he was an official intermediary. It meant, in the absence of fulfilling its obligations under the Judicial Assistance Agreement, Beijing nevertheless felt the need to contact her. But they didn't want to use the authorized, agreed official channels. And so they used this fellow, and apparently he's been used in other cases. But as Yu-Jie says, she wasn't having any. And they were trying also to make sure that they put him on TV. She wouldn't repudiate what he said, and they were trying to say to her, we won't put him on TV if you cooperate. I mean, it's really, this was a fascinating case. We haven't, of course, heard the end of it. And we don't know what will happen with the sentencing, whether she did right or wrong for her husband. She's obviously a very principled person. For those of you who don't know, the reference you heard to Ms. Li's own preoccupation professionally is to research and investigate Chiang Kai-shek's white terror that began in the late 40s. and persisted for decades in China. And this was the China or Taiwan I knew when I first went to Taiwan in 1961. It was not a very pretty place, and certainly not a place people were free to speak out. I think we have to close now because it's time for lunch. We're going to renew here at 1:45. Thank you very much.